Momento telefônica, a gente vai ter aqui o Steve Crocker falando sobre um pouquinho sobre segurança da internet. O Steve é um dos mais antigos colaboradores técnicos da rede, teve envolvido desde o começo, é o autor da RFC número 1, documento que cria os padrões da internet. Então vamos dar agora aqui o nosso aplauso inicial para o Steve. Go ahead, Steve, please.
Thank you very much, Frederico. It's a real pleasure to be here, and I appreciate the invitation. It's a huge party that you have going on here, and it's very exciting. I had the pleasure of being involved in networks going back a little more than 40 years, and one of the very first things that we learned about networking is that they bring people together. So I wanted to, I'm going to talk a bit about security, which is my specialty these days, but I also wanted to bring a little bit of the history from the past. And one of the things that occurred to me is that the time back a little more than 40 years ago, there was another party, very much like Campus Party.
My name is Sidney Westerville. I'm the owner of this antique tavern, Munger Valley, New York State. I was here when this crowd really came. We expected 50,000 a day, and there must have been a million. I myself was hungry for 2 days because I couldn't get any food, and I couldn't go out to buy any food. I was eating cornflakes for 2 days. And the kids were wonderful. I have no kick that was sir this and sir that, and thank you this and thank you that. Nobody can complain about the kids. This thing was too big. It was too big for the world. Nobody has ever seen a thing like this. And when they see this picture in the news, over the moving pictures, they'll really see something.
Delighted to be doing that here in Brazil. It's a beautiful country, warm people, delicious food, and not incidentally, a very big center of networking in every respect. Networking is an old technology. It existed even before electricity. Here's an example of reaching out for communication and getting together with other people long before we had electronics. A word or two about me. I currently run a small company, and I sit on the board of ICANN, which oversees the domain name system. This is all nuts and bolts, behind the scenes kinds of things. 40 years ago, I was at UCLA, where the first node on the ARPANET, which was the precursor of today's internet, was put together, and I helped organize some of those activities. I started out as your typical geek into mathematics and later into computers, and was just delighted to find that there was an opportunity to spend time around the university doing that kind of research. Back in the 1960s, and I better do something about this film, which is underway here. Come back to that in just a minute. Back in the 1960s and early 1970s, computers were pretty big objects. One computer might take up the room on this stage. A smaller computer, you might get two on this stage. We didn't have individual personal computers. We didn't have things that fit in your pocket. It was several years before we heard a report of the first computer being stolen. A big cheer went up around the community that they'd gotten small enough to steal. In those days, on campus at a major university, you could count all of the computers and keep track of them. And I remember being kind of annoyed one day when I heard that there was a computer that had been sitting in a department somewhere, and it had been there for a while, and nobody had told me about it. Nowadays, you can't even count the number of computers in the front row of this seat, of this group here. There were also no connections between computers. If you wanted to move information from one computer to another, you had to write it out on a magnetic tape or punch it out on cards or paper tape, physically carry it over to the other computer and read it back in. Very slow, very cumbersome, not very useful. There had been attempts during the early 1960s and middle 1960s to connect two or three computers together at a time, small numbers of computers. And for various reasons, those were relatively unsuccessful. The computers weren't built in a way that they had any natural connections to them, no physical hardware that made it easy. In the research community in the United States, there was an office within the Department of Defense that was sponsoring research in a number of laboratories on universities and research companies, and they could see that it would be useful to connect computers all the way across the country. That organization is called the Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA, now called DARPA, and its whole orientation was to fund research that would make a big difference, a factor of 10, not 10% was one of the slogans. And in the latter part of the 1960s, they decided that it would be useful to try networking on a bigger scale and get over the hump and make it happen. The research labs, as I said, were at these universities and some companies, and the research that was underway in those days was advanced work on graphics, on computer architecture, on programming languages, on artificial intelligence. All of that technology has been incorporated over the years into the devices that we use every day, into smartphones, Androids, iPhones, cloud, Google, and so forth. all of that comes out of the technology that was built. And so the ARPANET was built to connect these laboratories. Here's a diagram of the first part of the network. It consisted of four nodes. These nodes were at three places in California on the western part of the United States, and the University of Utah also in the western part of the United States. One of the things that we learned immediately was that there are people issues as well as technical issues. The places that on the east coast of the United States were a little less friendly about networking in the early days because they thought it might be a way for people to take the resources that they had. And so the decision was made to grow the network from west to east. Here's a picture about 6 months later with the network now beginning to span the continent from California to Boston. And it grew at roughly one node a month, and it continued to grow. Here's a picture 7 years later. And now, instead of trying to put it all on a map, it's just a diagram because you can hardly fit it in there. And we were overwhelmed that we were able to get 50 computers on a network across country. Nowadays, you can get 50 computers put together in about 10 minutes in a back room.
Mike, what's the worst part of running one of these things?
The worst part?
What's the worst part about running one?
I don't know.
Huh? Do you dig it all?
Yeah. I guess the biggest hassle is dealing with politics, you know?
There are a lot of politics involved, you mean with the cities?
Yeah.
And you got that solved?
Well, it looks that way.
Looks that way. How long did it take you to put it together? 2-3 months?
Working out for about 9 months.
9 months? Full time?
Yeah.
Are you in charge of the whole thing?
Yeah.
But you got backers, I presume.
Partners and backers.
Yeah. Where are you going to go from here? I mean, you going to do another one?
If it works.
Thank you! Oh, you're really good tonight. You know...
So about 9 months to put Woodstock together, about 9 months to put the initial ARPANET together, politics involved in both cases. 9 months for other projects, usually with a little less politics. Network was built with a single vendor creating what you would now call routers, Bolt, Brannick, and Newman, and no formal plan for what to do with the network. Quite a lot of energy, tremendous amount of engineering, in the wires that was connecting the sites and in the routers that would move the packets, the information from one site to another, and essentially no plan whatsoever for how to use this network or what to do with it. Instead, it was left to the researchers who were in place at each of these sites to figure out what to do with it. And so an informal cooperative process emerged organically from that environment. And it led to a very open arrangement in two very different and very important ways. From a technical perspective, the architecture was open. We designed layers of protocol with the explicit understanding that other people would add more to it, build on top of it, or if necessary, ignore what we had done and go around it, underneath it, through it, whatever. And we were very, very conscious that we did not understand all of the things that might happen. And we wanted to make sure that we left plenty of room. So instead of producing a complete product, if you will, or a complete service, we very deliberately viewed ourselves as putting building blocks in place that would make it easier for other people to do. It was the essence of what today you would call an open source environment and open architectures as well. The other aspect was from a social point of view. We made a point of having our entire organization open. And to say organization is to use too positive and favorable a word. We had meetings. The meetings were open to everybody. We created documents. We made a point of saying that these documents are available to anybody without cost. Better yet, anybody could contribute a document and write those documents. And to emphasize that point, instead of saying this is the standard for the network, we said each one of these documents will be called a request for comments. Even if actually we didn't care about getting any comments, we were sort of done with something. But as a matter of form, we said, we'll call every one of these requests for comments. We thought that this was going to be a very short-term, temporary arrangement of a few months. Those RFCs were started in April of 1969. We're now more than 40 years past that point, and the RFCs are still coming. And we still have a very open process. The original network working group started out as 10 people. It grew to a gigantic size of 50 people. We realized we couldn't fit everybody into one room. We had to have two meetings going on simultaneously. And we were sort of overwhelmed by the growth. Today, of course, that's nothing. The successor to the original network working group is the Internet Engineering Task Force. There are maybe 100 different working groups in progress at the same time. The meetings three times a year are 1,000 to 2,000 people, depending upon where the meeting is, and several more thousand people participate remotely. Here's a picture of two of my good friends, John Postel and Vint Cerf, in a sort of hokey picture that was put together on the 25th anniversary of the ARPANET. We posed for a picture in Newsweek. If anybody takes a look at this network, you can see that it can't possibly work. And I don't know why anybody would think that it would be useful to use fruits and vegetables for transmission lines. I mentioned that the documents are completely open. Any of you who want to do technical work, maybe you already read RFCs, but you certainly can get them. You can find them easily. I supervised them for a very short period of time, and then I went off to work for the government for a little while, turned things over to John Postel, and he did a spectacular job of providing exactly the right level of guidance, keeping his hands off and letting people do whatever they wanted to do, and providing a minimal amount of organization. Passed away a little over a decade ago, unfortunately. The ARPANET was a single network with an open architecture on top, but a closed architecture on the bottom. And it had a limit to how big it could grow. It could grow to be about 60 different sites, and that was the end of it. It didn't matter too much that it could only grow that big, because before it ever got to be as big as that, it triggered an immediate reaction in many different ways to cause other people to build networks. It triggered an interaction in a reaction in other countries, in England, in France, and in Canada, for example. The national governments immediately started projects to build their own networks. The ARPANET was built out of the U.S. Defense Department, out of actually a small corner of the Defense Department that was dealing with the research community and not actually dealing with much of the military. Other parts of the government decided to build their networks, the science community, the space community, the energy community, and other technologies were explored. Instead of using wires, packet radio and satellite-based networks were built. And then one very important, rather transformational development was that this large-scale network that connected computers across country was complemented by developments of what's now called local area networking, so that you could connect multiple computers in the same room or in the same building. Multiple technologies were tried, ring networks, and eventually Ethernet technology emerged as the dominant technology. all of these efforts, international efforts, multiple agencies, multiple technologies, made it instantly clear that we had to have a way to connect these computers, these networks, to each other. And so a lot of work was put into designing a network of networks, which we now call the Internet today, and to do so in a way that permitted each of the networks to be built and managed separately and grown separately, and yet to all cooperate with each other. A very complicated political and somewhat complicated technical effort that resulted in the architecture you see today, which, if you look at it, seems very, very simple. The unit of information that is passed from one computer to another is called a packet. It's typically 1,000 characters or less. And you send very large numbers of these, and they're all intermixed on a wire, each one of them addressed to where it's going. And as it reaches the router at the other end of the wire, the router says, okay, I know where this one's going to go, and sends it in one direction. I know where that one's going to go and sends it in a different direction. Getting all of that to work and to work smoothly is where all of the engineering work has been for the lower parts of the network over these past few decades. Meanwhile, at the upper parts of the network, the original issue, what are we going to do with this network, has remained a focus. In the early days, we did very simple things. We moved a file from one site to another. We would have a remote connection as if we were dialing up. But we knew that there were bigger things. And over a period of time, the World Wide Web came along. Well before the World Wide Web, we had electronic mail. When we first started, we didn't think electronic mail was very interesting because it was kind of slow and simple. Little did we know that everybody would start using email, and within a few years, that became the most common use of the network. When the World Wide Web came along, that became the dominant one. Now we have Facebook, Google, Twitter, and other kinds of applications. Behind the scenes, a lot of organizational work. The Network Working Group evolved into the Internet Engineering Task Force, with the Internet Activities Board overseeing things. The simple structure of writing documents and trying to keep track of them evolved into a larger and larger clerical problem. Every time somebody had something to keep track of, it created another clerical problem. And eventually, an organization just to keep track of the numbers came along. And then finally, as the network got to be big enough, we had to give names to the computers so that you could address things to them without having to remember their numbers. And the names got to be too many, and we had to invent the hierarchical system that is today's domain name system. You're all used to seeing curves like this that show the enormous growth. This is an old slide, 5 years old, 6 years old now, and it shows the growth leading up to 1 billion users, and now we know that there are two or more than 2 million users on the network. A more interesting way of measuring growth is who is using it and what kinds of communities. In the early days, the picture on the left is the picture of the group at Bull, Brannick, and Newman that built the routers. That's the entire group, a dozen people, more or less. After a couple of decades, as the network grew and grew, the public became more interested, because prior to that it had been mostly in the university and research community. And then finally, a major announcer on network television in the US, Tom Brokaw, did a story about the internet, and all of a sudden the internet was public. I like the picture on the right. This is actually Scott Bradner's mother, but it could be my mother-in-law, who never understood why her daughter married a computer scientist instead of a doctor. Her father, her husband was a doctor, her son was a doctor. She didn't understand why her daughter didn't marry a doctor. And worse yet, there came a moment during our married life when I had to, when we all had to move back into their house rather suddenly because my wife was ill. And I was running a laboratory, and I had to keep track of things, and I tried to bring a terminal into her house, and she took one look and said, There's no room for anything like that in this house, and made me take it away. Made me feel like a small child. I was, you know, I had two children at that point. I'm about 40 years old, and I was an adult out on the street, but not in her house. However, with the passage of time, we've provided her a laptop. She's taken great delight with stealing the Wi-Fi signals from her neighbor's house, and now my stock has risen considerably. Other organizations that have come along besides the Internet Engineering Task Force and ICANN, which oversees the domain name system and the addressing system for the Internet, the Internet Society, the World Wide Web Consortium, you had Tim Berners-Lee here, major development, made revolutionary changes in the network. And regional organizations, including many that are headquartered in South America, some here in Sao Paulo, some in Montevideo, and others in other parts of the continent. I've been involved with ICANN for several years. As I mentioned, it was born with the need to formalize and organize the way of keeping track of the addresses and the domain name systems for the Internet. And inevitably, as more and more people have used the network, security has become a bigger problem. So we have all kinds of abuse of one sort or another. So if we look at where ICANN spends its time, there is a very big space, both geographically symbolized across the top and in the subject areas symbolized along the left side there. I've listed some of the organizations. There's a little bit of U.S. focus here, but there's other organizations. And this is, I should have a pointer here somewhere. There we go. Now here's a law enforcement in the U.S. Here's a computer emergency response team, network operators group. There are corresponding organizations everywhere else in the world. And then ICANN has a sort of light overlay interacting up and down these different subject areas and all across the globe. Let me talk a bit more about security. In the early days, each one of the computers had some form of security passwords where you log in. And we all knew who all the users were. A typical computer, a time-shared computer that would be used in a laboratory, would have a total population of 30 to 100 different users. And if somebody was inclined to abuse their privilege of using the computer, we kind of knew who they were, how to get to them, and what to do about it. And when we started connecting these computers together, we knew in the early days who the other laboratories were, and we could kind of extend that system. So if somebody on the other side of the country was trying to log into my account and they were trying to give me trouble, we could track them down. I could call up my counterpart on the other laboratory and say, you got a problem over there, you should take care of it. This got out of hand as the network grew bigger and bigger, and now we have children and adults all over the world deciding that it's great fun to create viruses and worms and penetrate computers and create DDoS attacks. Not so good. We also had a limitation on what we could do. We had a little bit of cryptography, but the notion of what's called public key cryptography or asymmetric cryptography had not yet been invented. We now know actually that it had been invented but not been used, and it was kept behind the scenes in the intelligence community, but it had not been seen publicly, and it had to be reinvented by professors in the U.S. And brought out. And it made a huge difference in our ability to add security to these systems. So as I mentioned, we have break-ins, a singular event, a very important pivotal event. In late 1988 was the Morris worm that infected about 6,000 computers on the ARPANET by that time. A very bad day. Immediately led to the creation of firewalls and other kinds of software. and the creation of the first computer emergency response team located in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, as part of Carnegie Mellon University. A short time later, in roughly 1990, we began to understand that there was a particular flaw in the design of the domain name system protocol, and the technical term that was used for this flaw was cache poisoning. Let me give you a bit of an idea about how DNS works. Here's an example of what appears to be one single DNS lookup, when in fact there are many lookups required just to put the information needed to fill this page. That single page requires close to 100 different domain name lookups, because each part of the of what you see on the screen is a separate fetch from a different place, and each one of those has a different name. And in order to find out where it is, the information that's on the organizing page has just URLs or domain names of where to get that information. Here's a diagram of what the domain name system looks like from a symbolic point of view. Over on the right are the computers that are looking up names. Here are the computers that have the answers. If you want to know what the answer is for www.example.com.br, that question is sent over to a machine like this, and it sends back an answer like 1.2.3.4. It's actually done in a whole series of queries, not just one at a time, because it's done in pieces. Where is br? Where is com.br? Where is example.com.br? Where is www.example.com.br? And behind the scenes are the computers that are used to put the right information into these server machines. This is the provisioning or administrative part of the process. Here are all the places where things can go wrong. The arrows that are black show places where somebody who has access to the inside of the system could, if they chose to, put incorrect information in. However, it's the arrows in the red that are more disturbing. These are places where somebody outside the system could, if they chose to, put the incorrect information in. In this environment here, for example, you have an enormous number of open Wi-Fi systems of networks, and all of these connections like this that are taking place are in the clear, and it is possible for somebody to be running a laptop sitting right next to you, listening to your system asking, how do I find the following site? And there's nothing really that prevents the person sitting next to you from having his computer send an incorrect answer that your system will accept. And because they're sitting close to you, they may well beat the correct answer, and your system is perfectly happy to take the first answer that it gets. When this was demonstrated in the early 1990s, it created a bit of a stir, a commotion at the upper levels of the US government, and we started work rather urgently to improve the situation. And the method of improvement was to add what's called a cryptographic signature to every record in the system, so that the computers that are receiving the answers can check to see if the result has been tampered with, has been modified, or whether it is undisturbed, intact from when it was created. The concept was relatively simple and straightforward. Getting it done turned out to be much, much harder than we had anticipated. We've now been at it for 20 years. The number of things that can go wrong are the ones you can imagine. Somebody can steal your passwords, they can sit in the middle of the conversation and listen. And so we've been working diligently to improve that protocol. In essence, this protocol, DNSSEC, simply secures the name and address mapping so that the translation from the name to its numeric address is something that you can check to see if it's been changed. Here's a very quick summary from a technical perspective. I won't take you through all of these words. One of the reasons why it's taken so long is that the initial design, although it seems simple in its concept, we ran into some issues about what happens when you try to make this a truly large and broad-scale deployment. Certain things happen when you scale things up, it becomes a bit unwieldy, and we had to go back and iterate not once but twice. We finally have a final design. I put finals in quotes because it's not ever completely done. In 2005, and then there was emergent other requirements, some privacy issues and some additional key management issues. After this point, we asked the community across the entire world, please implement DNSSEC as rapidly as possible. That began the deployment process, and it's separate from the design process. It's more like a marketing campaign. You have to get people's attention. You have to get them to write software and develop it. You have to get products developed, services developed, documents. Have many, many, many meetings. Politics enters into it. I'm pleased to say that among the earliest adopters was the group here in Sao Paulo that runs the .br zone, Nick BR. I think they were second only to Sweden, which was also out in front. We now have about 20% of the top-level domains have implemented DNSSEC. This is quite some distance from everybody, but it is also quite some distance from the very beginning, and it means that we're well on our way. A key step was the signing of the root, which is on top of all the top-level domains. Uh-oh, something's happening. That's not the World Cup, is it? Something else. The root was signed in the middle of last year, and that was an important event from both a technical perspective of tying the whole system together and from a political perspective of sending an unambiguous message that DNSSEC is the protocol that has to be implemented. Let's get on with it. Here's a map that shows the state of development. Blue means completely implemented and up and running. The other colors are partial stages along the way. Note that Brazil is prominently in blue. This is September last year. Here's the projected for end of this year. Actually, the situation is a little better than what's shown here. We see activity that is happening faster than we can get it onto the maps. Let me look ahead also by looking backwards a little bit. I talked a bit about how we built the network, and we knew that we didn't know what all was going to emerge. That said, we did have some ideas about what was going to happen. So I've taken a look at some of the major technologies and services that we have today. We certainly knew about email. We knew about instant messaging. We hadn't built them, but we knew how to build them. The idea of Java as a language that you could write a program that would then be transmitted over the network and run remotely. It took about 25 years before this emerged in practice, but in the earliest of documents, we actually sketched out ideas along those lines. The World Wide Web made an enormous change. We had early versions of that idea working in laboratories and in small scale, but there wasn't enough infrastructure and shared protocols and developments around the network to make it ubiquitous, and so that too had to wait for a while, but it was clearly part of the vision. Even voice over the internet was something that we experimented with in the early days. We wouldn't have been able to tell you that the dominant solution would come out of Estonia. Most of us wouldn't have been able to find Estonia. I don't think we saw Google coming. I don't think we saw Facebook coming. I don't think many of us knew enough people to think about Facebook. What's going to happen in the future? A lot more bandwidth and better connectivity. That's very easy to say. It's more of the same, and it will have a big effect. We have, as I said, about 2 billion users now. There's another few billion still to connect. One of the things that has been a long time coming and will be a bit longer is the ability to talk to your computer, or you won't call it a computer anymore, talk to your appliance, and be understood. You can do a certain amount of that now. You can make an automatic telephone call and give some commands. But at some point, it's a little hard to predict exactly when, you'll be able to talk to a device with the same ease that you can talk to another person. And that will change things rather dramatically. Keyboards will recede somewhat. Automatic translation from one language to another can be put in series, and you'll see another major revolution. You'll see changes in businesses, changes in other kinds of organizations. The world is global, and in words of a prominent author, the world is flat these days. The door is open to everybody to compete and participate. It's of major concern in the U.S. because we see our jobs moving overseas. From my point of view, this is all very natural. And it's particularly important for places like Latin America and Brazil, because it means that the entire world is available. It also, of course, means that the entire world can compete with you, so it requires an energy level to get in the game and stay there. But if I know anything about Brazil in the few times that I've been here, there's no lack of energy. What to do? My strongest advice is to work on projects that are going to make a difference. Go after what you think is right, what you think will be helpful. There's plenty of money to be made, but mostly that takes care of itself. Work with others. The best projects and the biggest projects don't depend upon taking credit, but instead facilitating others. Credit will take care of itself. Take the initiative. Don't wait for other people. And engage in the kind of projects that are constructive and build things as opposed to tear things down. Let me bring back the mood here.
This is the most outrageous spectacle I've ever witnessed, ever. There's only one thing I wish. I sure gotta pee. And this ain't nowhere to go. I believe we're going to go up the country a little bit right now.
I'm going to some place where I've never been.
plug. I mentioned that the .br folks have been out in the forefront with implementing and deploying DNSSEC. There's a card like this every one of you has. There's a one-year free use of .br, your own domain name, using DNSSEC. Get involved. Try it out. The URL is on here. It'll make a big difference. Brazil is out in front and is a leader, and I want to enlist everybody to help continue that trend and do this, share it with your friends, and get everybody involved. Thank you.